are we? Good. Hey, we're going to be in Acts chapter 8 this morning. If you have a Bible, you want to flip there. And if you were here and you don't have a Bible, and so every week you're like, well, Matt, I don't have a Bible to flip to. We have a stack of Bibles back here on the bookshelf. Please help yourself to one of those and take it with you. We want that to be a gift to you from us. We want you to have God's Word in your hands. And so please help yourself if you need one. And the scriptures will be on the screen as well. And you can follow along on your phone. And so with that, we've spent too much time on that. Let's get into Acts chapter 8. We're going to finish out this chapter talking about Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch. So that's going to be a fun conversation. Want to start it this way. I had the just great opportunity to farm and ranch with my grandfather through junior high and high school. My grandparents lived on my great-grandfather's homestead, actually, in western Nebraska. And my grandfather lived there his entire life. And so when I kind of got into the junior high age, I got the opportunity to go out every summer day with him and spend time in the field and spend time working cows, and it was just the best days ever. Loved doing that. He was a dryland wheat farmer. And so when we would get to about July, mid to late July usually, we would start kind of eyeing the wheat and trying to figure out whether or not it was time to, you know, get the combines out and start harvesting. And one of the things that he would do that he learned over the, you know, he passed away in his mid-80s, and so over the 80 years that he had lived on that and worked that farm, one of the things that he learned to do was to walk out into a field of wheat, grab a handful of wheat and get just the kernels and throw it in his mouth, and by chewing those kernels, he could tell whether or not that wheat was ripe enough to harvest. And he was pretty much dead on. That's what you get after 80 years of doing that. And so when the wheat was ripe enough to harvest, then we would get out and we would start working. Humidity plays a factor in harvesting wheat. And so what we would do every morning is he would go out and he would, again, get a handful of wheat before we started up the combines. He'd put it on the hood of the pickup, and he had an old-timer pocket knife. I don't know if you have one of those or not, right? But he'd flip open a blade, and he would get 10 of those kernels separated out, and he would cut each one of them sideways. And if 8 or more of them popped, like jumped off the hood of the pickup, then the humidity was, it was dry enough in the air to get going and start cutting wheat. Again, when you do this for 80 years of your life, you learn when the wheat is ready to be harvested, right? And when it's ripe enough to be harvested. Throughout Scripture, there is a comparison to people. Last week we talked about people being sheep. Y'all love that a lot, okay? So, throughout Scripture, we are also fruit and crops, right? Fruit and crops don't make noise, Mark. Just saying. Not saying anything. Things are said like, the fields are ripe unto harvest. That's talking about people. It talks about how we are the vine, he is the branch. That's talking about our relationship with Jesus. We sow seeds, we thresh grain, right? So that is talking about us. And what my grandfather knew and what we know is that you cannot force crops or fruit to ripen, right? You cannot force, he could not go out, say, in June, and force his wheat fields to suddenly and magically be ready to harvest. You can't do it. And it's just the same for us in our spiritual walk as well. Like, we cannot force people around us to be ready to receive God's word, can we? We just can't do it. And so it's going to take time. And so what do we do when we're interacting with these people and we're working with these people and we're like, gosh, aren't you ready yet? We wait. Patiently. And sometimes the alternate understanding of that patience word more better applies, write that down. Notes, Matt. Long suffering. Sometimes it is long suffering. Some of you know that with your kids. not just in the spiritual realm, but certainly in the spiritual realm. So we wait, right? We wait patiently. We love them. We serve them. We take the opportunities that are presented to us and we talk to them, right? We do what we can in order to do our part, which we're going to talk about today, and we're going to allow God to do his part in their lives. And this is the story that we see in Acts chapter 8. As we finish this out with Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch, what we see here is that the Holy Spirit empowers God's people to go out and to do the good work, spread the good news of his message to people around them. And what we're going to see here is a man gets to become a part of that process with another man and just do a little bit, but he's faithful in his part, and God takes care of the rest, and it ends just wonderfully. And I don't know where you are this morning, right, in your relationship with God. And some of you, like, maybe you have not made that decision to make Jesus Lord of your life. I just want to say, like, if you don't know Jesus, I want you to know him. And we want you to know him. We want you to be connected to him. It's one of the most, it's not one of, it's the most important decision you can make in your life. And so we want to walk alongside you with that decision. And so, here we go. We're going to jump right on in, but we're going to start, and I want you to be thinking about this question throughout this entire time that we're talking about this. Who has God put in front of you? Who has God put in front of you that needs to hear the message of Jesus? Who has God put in front of you that needs to be served by somebody who follows Jesus? Who has God put in front of you who needs to feel the love of somebody who has the love of Christ in them? Who has God put in front of you? Think about that this morning. Acts chapter 8, starting in verse 26. We're going to take this in pieces this morning. Starts this way. An angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, character number one this morning. Spoke to Philip and he said, "Get up and go south to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is desert." So he got up and he went, and there was an Ethiopian man, a eunuch, and a high official of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who was in charge of her entire treasury. He had come to worship in Jerusalem and was sitting in his chariot on the way home, reading the prophet Isaiah aloud. So the Spirit told Philip then, "Go and join that chariot." So Philip is just minding his own business, right? Philip is just doing his normal thing. Angel shows up, right? Messenger from God. "Hey, you need to go out here to this desert dirt road and wait." And from the context, from what we see in Scripture, that's it, right? You go and wait. Bye. And he's gone, right? I mean, think about that. Like, that's really the only information that we know that Philip got from this. Who would have a problem with that, yeah? I would have a problem with that. I want to know, why are you sending me to the desert? Why are you sending me out to some road that I don't know what's going to happen? Who am I going to encounter there? What am I going to encounter there? What's going to happen to me out there? Like, I want to know the answer to some of these things, right? I want to know, like, the details. And I think we want to know the details, right? We want to know how things are going to play out before we commit to doing this or not doing this. But Philip here, again, the example we see from him, he gets up, he goes, not knowing anything else. He doesn't know what he's going to do. He doesn't know who he's interacting with. He gets up and he goes because he's faithful to God and wants to follow. So he gets up and he goes. Now, introduce character number two to this story, the Ethiopian eunuch. We know only a few things about this man, okay? Number one, do we know his name? Nope, I don't think mom named him Ethiopian eunuch. If he did, never mind. Okay, here's what we do know. We know he's from Ethiopia. Ethiopia is kind of current Egypt, Sudan area, okay? So that kind of reads into us some more. He is not a Jewish man. He does not have a Jewish background, okay? That's important. That's going to come up later. What else do we know about him? Who wants to say it? He's a eunuch. Okay, here's the deal. Context. He works for the the queen of Ethiopia named Candace. He is a top official with her. What happened back in this day was when you were offered a position like this, kind of top level senior executive, whatever you want to call it, in kind of this this structure, and you were male, and you were going to be working not only closely with the queen, but also with her advisors, her supporters, her family even, when you were going to be working closely with them, in order to prohibit, let's say, funny business. Come on. If you wanted the job, a procedure had to be done. I don't need to get into it anymore, right? We know what it is. Okay, so here's the deal. So he's labeled by that name. That's what it is. He's in the middle of nowhere here. He's coming back from Jerusalem. Interesting, he went to Jerusalem to worship. Not normal for somebody from where he is from and with his background that he has. But he's coming back from Jerusalem, and he's probably headed back to this godless nation of Ethiopia to work for this godless and pagan queen and kind of go back to this job that he has. And so he just happens to be sitting on the road here at this time in his chariot, and he's reading from the book of Isaiah, from the passage of Isaiah. And it's actually Isaiah 53, verse 7 and 8, which we're going to deal with here in just a minute. And here's the thing, like, it would have been really, really difficult in that day for a Jewish person to get their hands on actual scriptures, actual writings of any of the Old Testament prophets. Like, it would have been very difficult for that to even happen in the first place. There just wasn't that many around. There wasn't a Barnes and Noble that they could walk in and buy a Bible from, right? It just wasn't there. So for him to be able to get his hands on actual writings kind of says something. He's reading from this. So many times, especially in Jewish culture, so many of these scriptures were passed down verbally from generation to generation. That's how you passed it on, because there just wasn't any actual documents. But that's not the case here. He gets his hand on actual documents, which is quite incredible. And what we see here, ultimately, is that God is, like, preparing his heart. God is ripening him in this moment for this encounter that he's going to have with Philip. And so, recap. Angel comes to Philip and says, you need to go to this dirt road, right? You need to go to this place and meet this guy. And so he goes, or he doesn't even say meet this guy. He says, go to this place, right? So he goes to the place, and he says, well, go up to that chariot now and interact with whoever's in that chariot. And so Philip goes up to that random chariot and interacts with that guy. Now, here's the thing, right? Like, this is not a massive revival, is it? This is not thousands of people listening to Philip preach here, is it? And understand where we have been thus far in Acts. Like, most of the messages, most of the interactions that have happened in the book of Acts have been like Peter standing in front of multitudes preaching, and thousands of people coming to a saving relationship with Jesus through that, right? Like that's kind of been the standard. And now what we have here is we have one guy going to talk to one other guy. And I have to ask the question, like, why in the world would the good Dr. Luke include such what seems like an insignificant story in the scripture? As Luke is researching all of this out later on in years, as he's putting all this information together to put together this account, why would he include what seems insignificant? Why would he include Philip going and talking to one guy? This is not a massive tent revival here. Why would he include that? I have to believe, at least in part, it's because there was one person there whom God loved. And that one person needed to have one other person go up there and just be faithful to what God called them to do. And that is our story. That's our story, right? That is what we are called to be and to do. I don't think God's calling us, most of us, to lead massive revivals. I don't think most of us are being called to step up in front of thousands of people and preach these messages and have thousands of people respond to it. But I really do believe that every single one of us is called to be faithful to that one person. Whom has God put in front of you? Who has God put in front of you? So here's what we know. Philip was a man on Christ's mission. He wanted to be used however he could be in order to further the mission of Jesus. Philip is willing. He was waiting. And he did what he was called to do. He did. He stepped out and he followed without even knowing the information. There's a few things I want us to hear from this whole passage. The first one is this. God uses people to save people. God uses people to save people. Now, don't jump ahead of me here, okay? I did not say that we save people, okay? I didn't say that you and I go out and just save people on our own. God uses people like me and you to save other people around us. We are used as a tool in God's mission. God calls people like you and I, those of us who are disciples, who are followers of him, to speak and to serve and to love people around us. And sometimes that speaking and serving and loving people around us leads them to a place to where they are ready to enter into a relationship with Jesus. God uses people to save people. And here's what we see in Philip. Philip here is not going to save this guy, right? Philip is not forgiving his sins. Philip is not the one ushering this Ethiopian eunuch into, you know, eternity, right? That is not Philip's role here. That's not Philip's job, and that's not our job. And that's not our role, though sometimes we put that pressure on ourselves, don't we? Philip here is simply following the leading of God. He's simply being obedient to what God has called him to do and to be and to say, and allowing the rest to kind of be what it is, because God's got it under control. And here's the thing, another thing, like an angel was sent to Philip to kind of get this whole thing going, right? God could have, I believe, sent an angel to the Ethiopian eunuch, like he's driving down the road in his chariot, reading the scriptures maybe even, and then pop, I don't know how angels show up. In my mind, it's pop. So, gosh, that's not it. So up comes an angel, and there's an interaction there. God could have done that, right? God could have sent an angel, but he didn't. He sent Philip. And I get it. Like, we can convince ourselves that we're just not good enough for it. I think we can convince ourselves that we don't know enough, that we're not good enough, that we've not experienced enough, that we've not done enough to be used in the overall story of God, right? Like we have, I think we can convince ourselves that we are just so insignificant in the overall big picture of what God has done for the last 6,000 years, that we can then go, well, why in the world would God use me? Why in the world would God send me? Why in the world would God ever use me to talk to anybody else? I don't know all the answers, right? I don't have maybe a Bible education, right? Or I haven't been a Christian for very long, and we can get it all up in our heads that we are not important enough, that we are not good enough to be used by God to further his mission in this world. I think it's like this. I think the reason why God uses people, even like us, is like this. If you have ever had kids who are young, I think we can learn something from this. I have kids. They are 10 and younger, okay? They are with grandma and grandpa right now. Here's what I've learned. I can get a whole lot more done faster and done better when my kids are not around. Right? I'm not wrong. And you know it. Maybe you're just not willing to admit it. Here's the thing. When we have something that we need to do on a car, for instance, I have two little boys that love cars. And they want to know how these cars work. And they want to be out there. And part of it is they want to hang out with dad. And I get that. But part of it is they want to understand how this thing works. They want to be a part of it. They want to get their hands on tools. They want to get under the car. I don't let my kids get under the car. Okay? But they want to. Okay? They want to be out there and being a part of it. They want to do some of the work. Are they helping me? In their minds, they are. In their minds, they are. And they're trying, right? But I could do it a lot faster. I could do it a lot more conveniently. I could do it. I could get more work done in less time, right? Here's why I think this is important. God involves us, I think, in his work on earth because he, one, loves us, and two, he wants us to share in the joy of the work that is being done. If you've ever been able to be a part of somebody else's story coming to Jesus, there's joy found in that. There's joy found in God using you even just a little bit for somebody to make a decision to follow Jesus. We find joy in that, and I think God wants to share that joy with us. He wants us to feel that, and then to go on and continue to do it again and again. God is, in his love, he wants to share that joy with us. God uses people to save people. Second thing I want us to hear this morning is that we need to, this needs to have an S on it, but that's okay, that's my bad. We need to feel the urgency at times. At times we need to feel the urgency of the situation and what's going on around us. Let's continue reading verse 29 through 31. It says, the Spirit told Philip, right, get up and join that chariot. And when Philip ran up to it, he heard him reading the prophet Isaiah and said, do you understand what you're reading? How can I, he said, unless somebody guides me. And so he invited Philip to come up and to sit with him. And so here's what we have, because I think we have to be careful a little bit with this one. So I think there has to be a balance that we need to strive for between developing relationships with people for the long term. We need to find a balance between that and speaking when the Holy Spirit tells us to speak and only operating that way. There are people that will only sit in this camp and go, I don't need to build relationships. I don't need to fight for relationships, right? Relationships are messy, right? So I'm not going to do that, even though God calls us to. I'm just going to say the things that God tells me to say. And doing one or the other, I think, is really, really dangerous for us. And we need to be careful about that. So I want to be careful that we, as we kind of move through this, what we see here is Philip is listening to God and doing what he tells him to do. And in this moment, okay, in this moment, there is no real room for chit-chat, right? They're not developing a long-term relationship with each other. Philip was called here. He was brought here for a specific purpose, and we're going to see he's going to be taken away just as quick, right? And so Philip really is just being obedient to what God is calling him to do. And so Philip dives into this conversation. So what are you reading, man? Because the man's reading Isaiah out of Isaiah there. And I think at times this is absolutely the right thing to do. I think at times we find ourselves in situations where we don't necessarily know people around us, but we know for certain that we're supposed to go up to somebody and say something, that we're supposed to go up to somebody and pray for somebody, that we're supposed to go up to somebody and encourage somebody, or we're supposed to go up to somebody and pay for their groceries, or we're supposed to go up and do something with somebody. Like the Holy Spirit is clearly telling us, you need to go engage with this person in some way. And if we don't, we're blatantly disobeying the Holy Spirit. I don't want to be in that camp, right? But I also don't want to only be in that camp. I don't only want to say, I'm only going to respond when I feel like the Holy Spirit is telling me to say certain words only at certain times. I want to fight for relationships, and we're called to do that. See, what Philip comes from, his culture background, right, is in the early church to where they had relationship with each other, didn't they? They fought for relationships with each other. They had all things in common, right? They put all their things together. Like, they helped one another. They shared with one another. They had relationship with one another. That's the culture. That's the environment that he's coming from. But in this moment, God needed him to go and to do something for a very short amount of time. And so I want to be cautious here. Caution. Words are hard. I want to caution us here. I think it's unwise to only operate one way or the other. I think it's unwise for us to only say, I'm only going to say the words that God wants me to say, and I'm never going to try and be involved in relationships. We are called to be in relationship. We're called to develop relationships with people around us. And I think at times we can overdo, like if we're only in that mode of just, you know, not worrying about relationships, I think we can overdo that at times. A few weeks back, my care group, we were kind of joking about this a little bit, and half of them are in here, so that's good. But this kind of, you know, how do we interact with people, and how do we structure our conversations with people? And it can kind of go like this. I think we can overdo it in a sense when maybe somebody's talking to you and they say something like, man, Nebraska football team's really looking good this year, aren't they? Which they would never say, right? It's not a legitimate statement, right? But just imagine, let me dream, okay? Nebraska football's looking really good this year, aren't they? And you immediately come back and say, only God is good. Do you know him? It's a little much, isn't it? It's a little heavy, isn't it? I mean, if God tells you to say that, actually tells you to say that, the Holy Spirit is actually convincing and convicting you to say that, then say that. I've never felt the Holy Spirit say that to me in that way. I don't think it's an either or. It can't be an either or for us. It has to be an and both. We have to be ready for both. We have to be ready to engage in situations that God drops us in and says, hey, go do this right now. You need to be ready to do that. But you also need to be ready to invest in relationships and fight for relationships. And let the relationship that we have with people be the catalyst to them finding a relationship with Jesus later on. Are you with me? Okay. So we need to be ready. And we need to be watching for these situations. Number three, let's move on. Let the Holy Spirit speak. This is a continuation, right? But we need to let the Holy Spirit speak in our lives. I think sometimes we really, really struggle with this, right? And we try to force it on our own. And so the Ethiopian eunuch, he invites Philip into the chariot. And this is kind of the dialogue that they have. The next few verses, starting in verse 32, says, now the scripture passage that he was reading was this. This is Isaiah, okay? Isaiah says, and he was led like a sheep to the slaughter. And as a lamb is silent before its shearer, so he does not open his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who will describe this generation? For his life is taken from the earth. And the eunuch replied to Philip, I ask you, who is the prophet saying this about, himself or another person? So Philip proceeded to tell him the good news about who? It's going to come and play in a minute, right? Beginning from that scripture. So they start into this conversation, right? They dive into this conversation. The eunuch was reading from Isaiah 53. And Philip does more than just explain the immediate context of that passage. Like, I think at times we're tempted to just go, okay, this is Isaiah's audience, and this is his context. You know, this is kind of the history of it, and this is what was going on at the time. And this is how people maybe interpreted it. Like we have a temptation to only deal with, you know, Isaiah 53 in the realm of, you know, what was going on at Isaiah 53. But the bigger picture to this section is that this passage leads to Jesus, right? Okay, we're going to talk about that in a minute. But even more than that, here the bigger thing to this section is that Philip is not just speaking under his own power. He's speaking with the Holy Spirit in and through him. And I think this is an important thing that so many of us struggle with as believers, is trusting that the Holy Spirit is going to speak. And trust that the Holy Spirit is going to lead. And trust that the Holy Spirit is going to give us the words that are needing to be said at the times that they're needing to be said. If you're a follower of Jesus, if you're a disciple of Jesus, if you've committed to your life to following him, and you've confessed him, and you've repented of your sin, you've been baptized into him, you've committed your life to following him. If that's you, you have the Holy Spirit. You have the Holy Spirit, just like Philip had the Holy Spirit 2,000 years ago, right? You have the Holy Spirit, and yet so oftentimes we forget about him, and we try to live life on our own, and we try to engage in conversations on our own, and we try to do the work that we feel like we're called to do on our own. And that's a shame. I want to talk just very briefly about the Holy Spirit, just for a couple points on the Holy Spirit, okay? Number one, the Holy Spirit is not a force. It's not the force, okay? This is not like real-life Star Wars. He is a person. He doesn't inhabit his own physical body, right? He has a will. He communicates with us. The Holy Spirit is part of the Trinity of God, right? You have God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, right? And the Holy Spirit is a he. The Holy Spirit is not an it. The Holy Spirit is a he. The person of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit shows up. The Holy Spirit leads us and gives us words to say and convicts us and encourages us and does so many things for us now that Jesus did with his disciples back 2,000 years ago. Like, he tells Philip, get up and go to this guy. Go get in that chariot. Go engage in this conversation with this guy. Go talk to that guy. And ultimately what he's doing through Philip is he's saying, through me, through the Holy Spirit, go explain this passage to this guy. And for some of us, or for us, sometimes this is done internally. And sometimes our interactions, I think, with the Holy Spirit is done externally. Okay, so internally, like, we can have conviction. Maybe you've felt that before. Conviction really is not a bad thing. It's the Holy Spirit working on your heart, turning your heart back towards who Jesus is and who they desire for us to be. Conviction's not a bad thing. The Holy Spirit also kind of stirs up our conscience. Like, maybe we have a longing for something. Maybe we have a desire for something. Maybe we have that just itch inside of us, right, that we're supposed to do something. But the Holy Spirit can also be external as well, right? Like, the Holy Spirit can speak to us through other people around us. The Holy Spirit can use Scripture in order to get our attention. And scripturally, the Holy Spirit can speak to us through visions. Like, scripturally, that's a real thing. I know sometimes that makes people uneasy, but that's a very real thing, right? That the Holy Spirit speaks to us through visions. Some people, God speaks through his Holy Spirit, and you hear an actual audible voice of God. Like, these are all very different ways that we can have an interaction with the Holy Spirit. Now, here's the thing. I want to, again, caution us a little bit. God does not contradict himself ever. God is consistent. God is the same God from before he created everything around us. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Okay? So, if you have an experience where you believe the Holy Spirit is speaking to you or leading you towards something, internally or externally, you have this experience and you believe that what you are being told does not line up with Scripture, I caution you on following what you are feeling like you're being led to. Here's why. 1 John chapter 4 talks about how we need to test the spirits. And in testing the spirits, we know whether it's good or evil, right? There are evil spirits out there that want to act like God, that want to convince us that they are good like God, and want to speak to us in order to divert us away from God. We need to be careful. If what we are experiencing or hearing from a spirit or from what we believe is the Holy Spirit is not lining up with Scripture, we need to be very, very cautious. Okay? But that should not scare us and make us shy away from learning to hear from and know the Holy Spirit and listen to him and follow where he's leading us. To have the faith to step out in courage and interact with people who he's calling us to interact with. And trust even that he is there with us and that he's speaking to us. And that he's leading us, and that he's using us. You with me? We need to let the Holy Spirit speak. Number four, last one. Ultimately, we need to lead people to Jesus. Ultimately, we need to lead people to Jesus. This is the biggest thing, right? Like, most important thing. This is how this section ends. Verse 36. And they were traveling down the road, and they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "Look, there's water. What would keep me from being baptized?" And Philip said, "If you believe with all of your heart, you may." And he replied, "I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God." And then he ordered the chariot to stop, and both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and he baptized him. And when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord carried Philip away, and the eunuch did not see him any longer, but he went on his way rejoicing. And Philip appeared in Azotus, and he was traveling and evangelizing all the towns until he came to Caesarea. We need to be careful that at no point within our journey and our interactions with people, even when we believe that we're following the Holy Spirit and and doing and saying what we need to be saying, we need to be careful that at no point along this conversation does it point to us only. We are not the center of this conversation. We are not the hero of the story here, right? Like if we're in a conversation with somebody and somehow they walk away from that conversation without seeing Jesus, we have done something wrong. We've done something wrong there. Last week we saw it in Stephen, right? He used the Old Testament scriptures to point to the fact that these individuals were totally missing Jesus in their lives. They had missed Jesus. At no point of that was that about Stephen. They just got upset at what he was saying, right? And Philip here is doing it again. He had the opportunity to talk to this guy about Isaiah 53, and he could have built it around Philip, right? And kind of made a disciple of Philip there, but he points him towards Jesus. Points him towards Jesus. And we know even more that this is important because of how long Philip was able to stick around after the fact, right? They go down the water, baptizes him, comes up out of the water, and what happens? Philip gone, right? Philip is gone. It's not about him. Philip is not the hero of the story here. Philip is not the central character of this story here. Philip is simply being a tool being used by God, by Jesus, who is the central part of this story, to lead this Ethiopian eunuch to Jesus and then get out of the way and let God do what he needs to do. We have to make it about Jesus. We have to make it about Jesus. That at any point, our work becomes about us being recognized. If at any point, our work or our point becomes about us gaining status or position or recognition, we are doing it wrong. We are missing the essence of the gospel that we have been called to go speak on behalf of. This should not be about us. I am not called to make disciples of Matt. That would be bad. I'm not called to build up the kingdom of Matt. We're called to make disciples of Jesus. We're called to build up God's kingdom, to make him famous. What did John the Baptist say? He must become greater and I must become what? Less, least. It's about building up God. It's about building up his kingdom. I am just a small, minute tool that's being used in the process of God's overall plan and purpose in this world that is so greater than the 80 years on average that we live. So let's go back to where we started. Who has God put in front of you? Who has God put in front of you? I think for most of us, we probably know the answer to this, right? Because God didn't just put him in this person's name in front of us. They didn't just put this person in front of us right now. He has been putting this person in front of us for quite some time. Right? I mean, if we're being honest, this shouldn't be that hard for us. Maybe it's your brother, coworker, friend, whoever, right? Somebody that you know that you have a relationship with who doesn't know God. So who's God put in front of you? The truth is that God uses us to speak his truth and his grace into other people's lives. But guess what here? Like, this is the best news. We are not the ones responsible for how they respond. And that should be a good thing. We should be thankful for that. Paul says this in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Paul says, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So then neither the one who plants, Paul, right, nor the one who waters, Apollos, is what? Woo! But only God who gives the growth. Only God who gives the growth. We are simply being used by God to spread the message, to do our little part. And if we are faithful in that, if we are obedient to him, if we listen, if we follow, if we do, if we say, to have the conversations with people, to love them, to serve them, to speak, to do what we are called to do, the outcome is out of our hands. And it's not ours to bear like we so often want to bear. If you can say that you have done and said and been everything that God has called you to do, like in good conscience you can say that, then the outcome is out of your hands. It is not your weight to bear. We have our part. And if we're faithful in our part, then we're good. They have their part that they're responsible for. I'm not responsible for their part. They're responsible for their part. God's got his part. God's always going to do his part. But it takes all three. We must be faithful to our part. And the rest is out of our hands. So here's what we want to do as we end. If you have a bulletin, at the bottom of that bulletin, you have one last statement. If you don't have a bulletin, hopefully you have a piece of paper or something. But that statement is this. God has put in front of me blank. And I'm going to give you just a few what's going to seem like awkward seconds here in a minute to write a person's name down on there. Before you leave today, that person's name that you've been thinking about, right, that maybe God has put in front of you for maybe longer than you would care to admit, write that person's name down here. Or write it down on a different piece of paper, or then go home, and maybe you need to put it on a sticky note or whatever you need to do, but put it on a mirror somewhere, put it on your dashboard, put it in a place to where you're going to see it every day. And you're going to be reminded of this person. You're going to be reminded of the call that you have on your heart from the Holy Spirit to go engage in this with this person, to go build a relationship with this person. And take time when you see that person's name and pray for that person. But don't just pray for that person to come into a relationship with Jesus. No, pray for you to have opportunities to build a relationship with that person. Pray for opportunities you have to speak to that person, to share life with that person, and to point them towards Jesus. We get to do all of these things because we have the honor and the privilege and the opportunity to be used by God in order to affect eternity for other people around us. What a great honor that is. Let's not take it for granted. I'm going to give you just 10 seconds. Write the name down, and then we'll pray. I'm thankful. I'm thankful that you would allow us the opportunity to be used by you in order to further your mission and your purpose on this earth. God, I'm thankful for this example in Philip that we see of a man who has community, who has a world that he lives in, but is faithful when you call him to step out and go and do, even for just a short amount of time. Let us be like Philip. Give us the strength and the courage and the conviction to follow God, your leading, to whomever it is that you call us to. And then give us the strength and the courage and the ability to step out and to do and to say and to be who you call us to be with them. Thank you for that opportunity. Let us not take that for granted. Let us not hold on to salvation that we have through Jesus with you, God. Let us not hold on to that salvation that we have just for ourselves. But let us be about sharing that and spreading that to anyone that we can, everyone that we can. God, we thank you for Jesus and everything that he has done for us on the cross. I pray all of this